President Roosevelt called for the nation to become an arsenal of democracy that would provide arms for Britain's war against Germany. Congress, in September 1940, passed the nation's first peacetime conscription act and set the maximum number of draftees called to active duty at 900,000. When more than 16 million men between the ages 21 and 35 registered for the draft in October 1940, selective service officials felt free to set strict qualification standards for military service. With so many men available, the armed forces decided to exclude certain groups of Americans, including women, blacks in the Marines and Army Air Corps, and following the advice of psychiatrists, homosexuals. The rationale for disqualification was the same for each of these groups. Officials believed that they made poor combat soldiers, their presence in units would threaten morale and discipline, and their integration would turn the military into a testing ground for radical social experimentation rather than a strong fighting force.
Fall in. Present arms. Order arms. Parade rest. Attention. Forward march. Left, 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 right. Company halt. Right face. About face. Forward march. Left, 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 right, left, 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 right, left, left. Company halt. Left face. About face. Parade rest. Seaman Chris, Seaman John, gunnery checks.
Sir, yes, sir.
Seaman Anthony, Seaman Phillips, Seaman Robin, deck swabbing.
Sir, yes, sir.
Seaman Elias, Seaman Joel, electrical systems checks.
Sir, yes, sir.
Does everybody understand their jobs?
Sir, yes, sir.
Dismissed.
Thank you.
18 million young men in the United States were examined at 6,400 draft boards, where Army psychiatrists were expanding the military screening system, which focused, increasingly, on homosexuality. Homosexuality was described as a constitutional psychopathic state, and psychologists diagnosed homosexual men and women as sexual psychopaths. The framers of the Army's interwar physical standards listed feminine characteristics among the stigmata of degeneration that made a man unfit for military service. It was advised to have candidates strip and remain naked during their interviews. Possible signs for identifying male homosexuals included a degenerate physique, sloping shoulders, broad hips, excessive pectoral and pubic adipose deposits with a lack of masculine hair and masculine marking, a young man with a scant or downy beard, effeminacy in dress and manner, a patulous rectum. These telltale signs helped clarify procedures for rejecting gay draftees. Sexual psychopaths or sexual deviants were too sissy to become good soldiers.
How you looked when you smiled, only forever. That's putting it mild. Take me to be near if you beckon. Offhand, I would figure less than a second. Do you think I'll remember how you look when you smile? Only forever. That's putting it mild.
Consequences for being bound out were harsh. Until 1944, Article 134 of the Uniform Code of Military Justice, or UCMJ, stated, a service member who engages in consensual sex with an adult of the same sex faces a maximum penalty for sodomy of 5 years imprisonment, forfeiture of all pay and allowances, and dishonorable discharge. Barbaric tactics were used to shame homosexuals who were found out. Many gay GIs were sent to queer stockades, where taunts, humiliation, and degradation from fellow soldiers took their toll. Such humiliation could put an already depressed person over the edge. The presence of gay GIs on public display, as well as the secret disappearance of gay suspects in the night, taught other GIs to be terrified of getting too close to one another and associating with known queers.
Thank you.
II's massive human mobilization, the military shifted from its practice of jailing soldiers accused of homosexuality, which required time-consuming, expensive court-martials, to simply deeming them psychologically unfit. Blue discharges could be dispensed to anyone with undesirable traits of character, a term ultimately applied in large numbers to queer people. The details of these records were public information. When revealed to family, spouses, and employers, the consequence of a blue discharge could be deeply life-changing. Many people suffered interrogation, incarceration, public disgrace, and being treated as if they were the enemy. This forced gay servicemen to fight two wars, in and out of the service. One of the most vindictive punishments meted out to these veterans was the denial of GI benefits. Ironically, the extreme and sometimes violent measures taken against gay men and women often forged bonds of comradeship among them as victims of injustice that strengthened their sense of being members of a persecuted minority.
Thank you.
By the time the fighting ended, the lives of gay soldiers who survived combat were changed in fundamental ways. The closer they had come to combat, the more they understood how much they were needed and valued by the people they liberated, the military organization, and their comrades in arms. On the battlefields, some of these men had the chance to experience what it would be like to live in a world where prejudices against male-to-male love, affection, and sex were suspended, if only temporarily. Simply by doing what they were expected to do, they powerfully challenged stereotypes that portrayed homosexuals as poor soldiers, proving to their heterosexual buddies, other gay soldiers, and themselves that they would not let each other down. It is one of the many tragic ironies of war that gay soldiers and officers had to kill, risk their lives, and see their buddies die in order to gain some respect and sense of belonging as men among men.
Thank you.
a stronger sense of themselves as gay men and women helped shape the idea that homosexuals had rights and could engage in their own fight for justice. The generation of gay men and women who served in World War II grew into adulthood, fighting one war for their country and another to protect themselves from their government's mobilization against them. Today, they witness an expanding public debate over the military's exclusion of homosexuals. If that debate is all too serious, it must include a sense of history, not only of how the military established its anti-gay policy during World War II and then suppressed all internal dissent, but also of how the men and women who were the policy's first targets fought and died for their country with the rest of their generation. On September 19, 1964, the very first public demonstration for gay rights in the United States took place outside the U.S. Army building in Lower Manhattan. Organized by Randy Wicker, gay men and lesbians were joined by straight allies to protest the military's discriminatory policies against LGBT people. Turns out sissies make great soldiers. Sissies make great everything.
Tonight.